Okay, so let me give you my GPS, right? Is this what people do these days, where we stand, where we are? So you know when we use certain terms, is this on the microphone? Okay. What I mean in particular, which bears on this talk at the rather basic level. So to begin with, quantum gravity, I define it as the theories of the microscopic structure of space-time. I think this definition, most people who said they are working on quantum gravity can agree to, okay? If you don't agree, raise your hand, then I'll say except one, okay? Next time when I give a talk. And I could also say that, well, this, of course, has been decades of work by quite a number of people, increasing number of people, let's say, that quantum gravity is not quantizing general relativity. I learned that thing from Fortini, right, quantizing that. And in particular, I realized that people still sort of use terminologies interchangeably when they have in mind quantizing some weak perturbations of a background space-time, okay? To me, that's certainly not quantum gravity. And it is also commensurate with gravity viewed as an emergent theory or an effective theory. If you view the space-time structure as the hydrodynamic limit of some known or otherwise unknown, yet to be discovered, theory of the microscopic structure of space-time. So it's emergent from those theories. There are quite a bit of examples, half a dozen at least, that I could name. Strings, loops, causal sets, etc. If you view them, the current theory and also the structure of space-time as emergent, quantizing it is absolutely legal, and it is, however, it is at the same level as phonons, like quantizing sound, or quantizing hydrodynamic perturbations of some smooth manifold. And that certainly is a far cry from what I refer to as quantum gravity. So with that out of the way, this talk is actually probably the simplest compared to all these sophisticated theories that we've heard beautifully, because really it's about quantum physics and gravity. And I could also say that for the longest time, I have held the opinion that even without going to this level, which usually applies at the Planck scale, I think there's yet a lot of interesting issues that we need to do a little bit more thinking, purely just taking quantum and gravity. This is a plus, not even in a circle, you know, versus that. That's certainly a way of, you know, many orders of magnitude in difficulty, okay? And in this talk, the reason why I said it's the simplest is because it's non-relativistic insofar as gravity is concerned, quantum mechanics is concerned, and also weak field. Okay, so this is really, this cannot be any simpler. And I think today, Professor Toff mentioned that this is quantum mechanics, beginning quantum mechanics, so we're still at this level. So let's move on. I'm gonna skip this slide. This basically explains why, and maybe I should say this also, this is a good time for people to do this because, no, I'm fine, yeah, because there's also, many of you know that, you know, if you really want promotion or getting appointed, you need to have a few papers appearing in Nature. And the best way is actually to collaborate with the experimentalists, unless you can set up the world's best laboratory. And there's a sociological reason behind it, having seen, witnessed the field for three or four decades. The pendulum has swung in this side. Now, Recently, and thanks to the experimentalist friends in AMO, atomic molecular optical physics, and so on, they have coined a new word, okay? That's another thing to do to be in the news. It's called gravitational quantum physics. Okay? No, I mean this with, you know, certainly quite some degree of seriousness, okay? Because they have been working on quantum physics, and the AMO people probably have the best experimental means that they could manipulate in the best possible ways and give you the most sort of precise readings of things. And they are coming close to, so in recent years they've added on the gravity. So instead of, so now you also have GQ, isn't that nice? Yeah. So GQP is a hot topic, okay? And of course it's not a hot topic that we care about. It also contains some of the fundamental issues both in quantum as well as in gravity. So because of all these reasons, I think it's also a good thing to pay some attention to that. Of course, we've been doing all these things for a long time. And this is really a summary of the kind of issues that made people sort of turn their attention to gravitational quantum physics. Now that I'm done with that, it could be in the recess. Let me just mention one thing in particular. Is this the thing? Yeah. I don't think they would agree on this name, but I just call them collectively alternative quantum theories, okay? One of the best knowns are the Dioghi-Penrose scheme, which I'll refer to in a couple of slides later. I won't get into details because time is quite limited. I just want to bring this to your attention. If you trace it back, it actually evolved in the 80s, at the same time, almost the same time when semi-classical gravity was established in quotes, okay? So you can see that actually these people were fixing their attention on the quantum side, okay? And largely ignoring what had happened since even the late 60s on with the advent of quantum field theory in curved space-time in the 70s, certainly the whole renormalization, regularization program pursued in the mid-70s, which resulted in, of course, making it possible to look at the back reaction program, which is what established the semi-classical gravity theories. And they pretty much just went on and motivated mainly by the fact that the classical world is very different from the quantum world. Okay, we believe that fundamentally everything is quantum mechanical. It applies to, of course, microscopic ingredients, not of space-time at least, okay, of matter, right? So, but then in the classical world, we don't see, you know, physical objects appearing here as well as in the next door. So this kind of wave function, they call it, well, there's a size, a scale, wherein the wave function collapses. So there's this kind of collapse. And it's a theme and variation surrounding this point there. And certainly, I mean, that is a legitimate question. And there are different sort of theories proposed to try to resolve that issue. I don't think anyone would say that any one of these theories have been successful so far. But it certainly caught the attention of a sector of people who used to be regarded more as philosophers, but since now we're also in a country that's very rich in philosophy of science, I think this is also a good time, even if you're interested in philosophy, to pay some attention to what's going on at that really sort of basement level of physics, which you can't even see now. So the related thing, of course, talking about you have to be sort of to have a certain sex appeal to even sort of move around in this sort of academic world term business. So they got very interested in gravitational decoherence, and suddenly even simple sort of gravitational redshift, right? If you climb up the fifth floor, you have a different gravitational redshift factor. Even in nature, they dare to call those gravitational decoherence. Okay, so in a way, I'm urging this audience or the colleagues here to pay some attention to that, so that some truth value, to give it a little bit more truth value in those things that they view as sort of sexy, okay? It's a serious business, okay? It's easy to sort of go down the road of totally not only decohering things, but deconstructing things and decohering things. We don't want to see that happen, okay? It's a serious, you know, inquiry and so on and so forth. But certainly, you know, working with the experimentalists, as I also, you know, indicate in the last several slides, would give you the kind of momentous and to push things a little bit harder. It's not just conceptual anymore. This is what I learned from Bill Phillips, my colleague at Maryland, who always, you know, after you give them a theory, he said, how am I going to test it? How am I going to, what should I be measuring? Okay. And I stopped there. And, you know, I showed, that's it, okay? I don't know how to do that. There's a big gap, actually, between whatever equation that you find is most beautiful and, you know, most useful, to what really is useful for people who want to observe something directly from whatever you tell them, you know, from your theory, okay? So at least I find that very educational in the last 15 years in my association with people in quantum optics and atomic physics. I won't go into all those things because I'm quite sure you know all of these. That's really for the benefit of people in alternative quantum theory. Sometimes they say, well, semi-classical gravity is no good. But no good for what reason? Not knowing that actually there are several layers of that, even under this general banner of semi-classical gravity. And if you read in the literature, sometimes it's called the Miller-Rosenfeld equation, it is the same as the semi-classical Einstein equation. So what I really want to talk about is this very last part here. So in addition to quantum and gravity, how do you put quantum information in these systems? Because that's another thing that's sort of at the front line and sort of sexy in appeal. You have to learn a little bit about quantum information. I don't know that much about it, and what I'm going to talk to you about today is really confined to the really, really, really basic, the cat, okay, the cat state. How do you define a cat state? Why do we worry about a quantum cat state in the gravitational quantum physics context, and what does that entail, okay, experimentally even, okay? I should mention, let me do a little bit of publicity for Manelli, okay, who actually supposedly just arrived today in Utrecht to start his sort of PhD study in the philosophy of science program there. I won't have time to go into the experimental possibilities. That's why I would suggest, if you like, read that paper recently posted, wherein we've found out, mainly it's his work, identified from the current experimental schemes proposals, which is the best for preparing a gravitational cat state, and then which is the best in measuring a gravitational cat state. Okay, so those, that belongs to sort of experimental possibilities. If you really want to get your hands dirty, so to speak, okay, or your feet dirty, descending from this level, okay, to rock down there, yeah. All right, so those are the three elements, quantum information and gravity. So quick review where we stand, right? So quantum. By quantum, we, of course, have in mind quantum field theory, which has been extra successful in describing the micro world. This micro world is different from this one, by the way, okay? This, of course, is the subatomic or even subnuclear level. And then gravity, of course, it's our beloved theory, general relativity, which describes, as far as we know, as large a scale within observational bounds, the macro and the micro. You can see that's another thing that interests me, is the micro-macro versus quantum classical, all that on the crosshair. So the semiclassical gravity, simply put, is really general relativity plus quantum field theory, but demanding self-consistency. So in the Einstein equation, the source, it's classical source. If you just take the mean value or the expectation value of the stress energy tensor as the source, but also demand that the background space-time dynamics should evolve according to the dynamics of the quantum field that make up the material source, the matter source. Okay, so it's really solving those two equations simultaneously. Now, the contrast here is that, can you read the last line from the back there? Right, is that for since the 80s, so about, I don't know, three decades now, we've been working on strong field conditions. So the application of semiclassical gravity really was targeting the early universe behavior and black hole end state situations, okay? Now, this actually is beginning to sort of show some relevance. That's another key word if you want to be famous these days. That's related, of course, to the advances in cosmology in the last decade or two even, right? With all the experiments, the observations, it's a beautiful thing, a golden era of cosmology. And people are just now beginning to realize that it takes serious work, okay, to do some calculations. We saw that in the earlier talks. Really, it's no nonsense taking everything seriously in order to get some number that you can compare with observation. Just hand waving like in the 80s in sort of cosmology, early universe type, no longer can serve the purpose. What I'm pointing out today is actually here, right here. So it's laboratory conditions, and you can presumably even test things out on a tabletop experiment. Okay, so that's the beauty of this. That's what underlies this new sort of impetus known as gravitational quantum physics. All right, now let's just review a little bit on the cat state, which we all know, I mean, the Schrodinger cat state from quantum mechanics. But if you add in the consideration of gravitation, you see actually it's a manifestation of a deeper sort of level of the intrinsic conflicts between quantum and gravity. So at the risk of maybe overrunning, I was debating whether I should show these following three slides. It's sort of verbatim from Roger Penrose. Shall I do that? Or, I mean, I think the audience here is way, of course, you're fully aware of the contradiction, okay, that Penrose pointed out, okay? Maybe I should just read this, and in fact, I said, well, just read the letters in red if you feel like falling asleep, okay? So, he actually proposes, of course, much earlier, but I found this paragraph in the 1996 paper very, very clearly stating this, okay? So, addressing the question of stationarity of a quantum system, right, which consists of a linear superposition of two well-defined states, alpha and beta, each of which would be stationary on its own, and where we assume that each of the two individual states has the same energy. Look at this, right? This is certainly first year, or maybe sophomore quantum mechanics, okay? So, just quantum mechanics alone, right? So, sometimes we don't think twice before we write down this equation. Psi is alpha plus beta, okay? With A and B coefficients, amplitude, okay? And then we say, okay, would also be stationary with the same energy, and then, okay, we develop. Already there's a contradiction if you bring in the consideration of the basic principles of general relativity, okay? With gravity, however, when the gravitational field of the mass distribution of the states are taken into account, we must ask what the Schrödinger operator actually means in such a situation. Let's consider that each of the stationary states, alpha and beta, takes into account whatever the correct quantum description of its gravitational field might be in accordance with Einstein's theory. Then, to a good degree of approximation, there will be a classical spacetime associated with each of alpha and beta. The emphasis is each. Right? We know that, of course, in order to make this well-defined stationary, you need a killing vector, right, would correspond to the action of the killing vector representing the time displacement of stationarity in each case. So even if when you define a quantum state and you want to perform a superposition of two quantum states, you run into that danger. Stationary states make demand of space-time properties and the clash of quantum mechanics and general relativity. So the problem that arises here is that these two killing vectors are different from each other. It's not like you can take these two killing vectors and apply it to the same space-time and then safely just add them up and assume it's a stationary state and start the story from there. This is really just the beginning of any story told in quantum mechanics, if you care to bring in what we know about general relativity, the basic principles of general relativity. This is Roger, right? They could hardly be the same, right, as they refer to the time symmetries of two different space-times, okay? All right, now, so it could only be appropriate to identify, right, the two killing vectors with one another if it were appropriate to identify two different space-times with each other point by point. So it's tightening, right, the gap and pointing out the clash between really the basic principles of quantum, the superposition principle, and gravity, in this case, the covariance principle. And then Roger continues, but such an identification would be at variance with the principle of general covariance, a principle that's fundamental to Einstein's theory, right? So, according to standard quantum theory, unitary evolution requires that there be a Schrödinger operator that applies to the superposition, just as it applies to each state individually. And its action on that superposition is precisely the position of its action on each state individually. So, this is the third time he's sort of repeating this point to hammer it in. And you can see that there's thus a tension between the fundamental principles of these two great theories, okay? And one needs to take a position on how this tension is to be resolved. So this is really quantum plus gravity and really at the rock bottom of something we could relate to, even non-relativistic and in the weak field limit. Because it's a matter of principle. It's not, strong or weak field that you can get rid of these basic contradictions. So Penrose's position is, and he emphasized provisionally, that was in 96 at least, right, is to take the view that an approximate point-wise identification may be made between the two space-time, okay? And that this corresponds to a slight error. So here it is, you have to allow for this and tolerate this slight error in the identification of the Schrödinger operator for one space-time with that of the other. ddt is a killing vector because you need it to be a killing vector in order to define a stationary state. This error corresponds in effect to uncertainty the energy of the superposition, and then he moved on to saying that it turns out to be the gravitational self-energy of the difference between the mass distribution of the two superposed states. You see here the mass distribution comes in, of course that's where gravitational issues are of relevance, okay? And this energy uncertainty, no wonder people said this could go out of control, yeah? Okay, I think, yeah, we're back to this page. So this energy uncertainty is taken to be a fundamental aspect of such a superposition, and in accordance with Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, this is a reciprocal thing is taken to be a measure of the lifetime of the superposition. It's like the natural lifetime of the atom and et cetera. So it's sort of built in to any theory if you care to pay some attention to the gravitational principle, the underlying principles of general relativity. I mentioned Dioscuri-Penrose. Another equally sort of long existing theory is the Gerardi-Rumidi. Weber and Pearl, etc. And they talk about the localization as I just briefly related to earlier. I would regard all these theories as phenomenological, not fundamental. It's a far cry, of course, from what we have seen in the last, again, 30 years almost, if you count string theory. 1987 is getting close to that, yeah. All right, so I should also mention viewing gravity as emergent, right, in the proposal of sublevel. I would call these theories as phenomenological, but for example, Steve Ellis' book, he's outlined a way that there is an underlying level wherein hopefully quantum as well as gravity are both emergent from that underlying level. And certainly Professor Toff had been sort of very creative in his own way of looking at the different issues posed here. So I would suggest if you really want to go into a little bit deeper those papers, as well as there's a review in 2013 by Angelo Bassi. Let me just quickly mention something relevant to this. Since earlier I mentioned gravitational decoherence. Gravitational decoherence refers to the fact that you can have decoherence due to gravitational effects. The reason why it's sort of singled out in its importance was because, I don't know whether Roger directly said so or not, but he thinks that gravity has a special role to play in what we see in a classical world coming from quantum. So that's sort of decoherence due to gravitation. A couple of years ago when I saw Roger, he said, well, decoherence may not be such a good word. Maybe entanglement is a better. I don't know whether he's serious about it, but entanglement seemed to. Actually, entanglement, so we have experts in the audience, refers to something also very specific. But let me just give one of these sort of canonical examples of what it's the quantum Brownian motion model. Simply, again, it's just harmonic oscillator. So this is the system, harmonic oscillator action, and then the bath is made of n harmonic oscillators. Little n goes to capital N, with bilinear coupling. This is the model that people have worked for ages, certainly since the 60s, early 60s, Schwinger, Feynman, you name it, almost everybody. I mentioned this group of papers because we have both the master equation, as well as when Juan Pablo went to Los Alamos, also did this calculation. In the next slide, I'll show the results from their paper there. So here it is, okay? It's a superposition state one and two of two Gaussians peaked at plus or minus L0. So the wave function is the superposition of these two with a definite P0, the momentum, initial momentum. And you just let it evolve in time. And here's the result. Just focus on this line, this column here, because this is P and X in phase space, and this is what's plotted is the Wigner function. I have a slide on Wigner function later on, but bear with me, you can just visualize this as originally these two humps at the locations plus and minus L. This has already evolved a little bit, right? T equals 0, 0, 0, 1. This is the sort of initial interference thing in the Wigner function. And then in time quickly, you can see that sort of separated, well separated. Well, in a time which is faster than that, which is illustrated here, if you start out the wave packet centered at plus or minus P0, let's say. That's an illustration of what Wojtek-Jurek called the pointer basis. Let me not get in, which of course comes from the symmetry, certain symmetry in the interaction Hamiltonian. Let me not get into that direction, but just want to illustrate what a cascade is, not even gravity, right? There's no gravity involved. Yeah, please.
What is the state of the other oscillators in this example?
In what state?
So you have the Gaussian for the first oscillator, but equals coupled to many others. And I'm asking, what is this?
You mean the bath, right? It's finite temperature bath. Ah, boy, that's the problem. Okay, so I'm going to skip over all of these. Never mind about. Semi-classical gravity, you also understand, as I said earlier. Well, yeah, this is really the classical term, right, already. Even not paying attention to any quantum field, this has served great purposes, both in classical solutions of Einstein equation, as well as the standard model, cosmological model. And usually one would think that the quantum matter field would become relevant also, again, near the Planck scale, certainly below, but close to the Planck scale. And notice that this is the expectation value with respect to some quantum state, okay? And this is what I was referring to earlier, that the matter, let's say in this case, is massive scalar field, obeys, of course, the Klein-Gordon equation. And the box notice, right, is the Laplace-Bartromy operator, of course, defined on a particular curve space-time, the G with the metric G alpha beta. And that's how these two equations are linked, and you need to solve them self-consistently. There are many things involved. It's not as simple as one could imagine from looking at this equation. For example, the regularization or the renormalization of the stress energy tensor. There's quite a bit of work in the 70s and so on. So that's why by the late 70s, I think this theory is quite well defined, established. And what remains, of course, was to seek solutions to this equation, which is surprisingly sort of scarce in really finding the solutions and the implications for early universe. And maybe that's the reason when the observations come closer and closer, I think people would have to take that seriously. Okay, so as I said, the most sort of basic element in quantum information is the issue of quantum entanglement. I mean, this is really a deep issue, and supposedly what makes quantums uniquely quantum, okay? So a cat state, let's say on the left and the right, okay, just like the plus and minus L0 and the superposition thereof. So I just want to point this out with limited time, that semi-classical gravity is just not adequate to deal with any issues in quantum information. Okay, because if you use semi-classical gravity, you're going to conclude the mean field, the cat sits right at the middle. Okay, that defeats the whole point, right? The whole point here, of course, is that it's a superposition state, and so it can cope, it being a mean field theory, it would wrongly predict peaking at the average value. And likewise, it does not emit a cat state, so if you work at that level, there's no way that you could even consider the simplest of quantum information. You need to include contributions from the fluctuations. Of course, better yet, if you could describe the whole state, but this at least is the beginning to depart from the mean field or the mean value. So the correlation of the stress energy tensor, two-point function of the stress energy tensor, is needed at least to address the issue of quantum information with gravity. So gravitational quantum physics, this becomes a starting point. And there is such a theory known as stochastic semi-classical gravity. It's too bad Enric just left before he even saw this term. It was in the 90s that I sort of proposed it, but Enric has been doing the greatest amount of work in working out what we call the noise kernel over here in a couple of slides, as well as seeking solutions to what's known as the Einstein-Langevin equation. Okay, so you can see that if you allow for noise and fluctuations on the right-hand side, stochastic in nature, and of course you observe the validity of the Einstein equation, in this context, a semi-classical Einstein equation, there's got to be fluctuations in the metric. And sure enough, that is the metric fluctuation. That's why I'm very careful in not using, perturbations using the word fluctuations for perturbation because these are deterministic functions, whereas those are really stochastic functions. So the metric fluctuations, a more poetic and even earlier term is the space-time form of Wheeler in the early 60s, late 50s or so. So compared to the earlier slide, this is the only thing that's new, right? The quantum part we've seen, the stochastic term arises there. You might wonder, what allows you to suddenly just add a term to an equation, okay? That actually was the biggest struggle I had in the early 90s. How could, you know, an equation, such a beautiful equation, the marble, right, on the right, at least on the left-hand side, allow for such a, you know, casual thing of talking about dissipation, right? We did that in the late 70s and 80s, and now even worse, okay, adding noise term to it. So there's, you know, we really need to justify it, and so the noise kernel really is the answer to the story to the question I just posed. Is the expectation value of the 2-point correlations of the stress tensor or the bitensor, and the noise kernel measures the quantum fluctuation of stress tensor. That's what it is. Okay, nothing more or less. If you give me a feel, I would be able to write down the correlation function. First of all, I would be able to define the noise for you, at least under the Gaussian condition, Gaussian approximation, thanks to the Feynman-Vernon sort of identity these days we call it. Okay, so these are, you know, you can view it as noise, but in nature, they are just the 2-point function of the T mu nu of the stress energy tensor. And Enrique and his students prove that this is a symmetric traceless for a conformal field and divergenceless. So it satisfies all the conditions that you usually require, of course, of the Einstein tensor on the left-hand side, etc. Okay. So I mentioned this earlier, that this theory, since its inception, 94, around that time, has been aiming at the strong field limits, and usually we work with the vacuum expectation value of the stress energy tensor 2-point function. Now, the equation now is called the Einstein-Langevin equation because there is a noise term on the right-hand side, and that actually brings forth, well, even the semi-classical gravity level without that term, you can see dissipation appearing in the space-time dynamics. That was from the late 70s in the work with Jim Hartle and Leonard Parker, a few other groups later on. But here now, with this term, as I just said, you will actually see metric fluctuations arising from the space-time dynamics. Okay, so here's a review if you want to know more about that. Let me actually, I haven't even started the main theme of the talk, which is, yeah, so, all right. So let's look for the gravitational quantum catch. Now that we have a theory, at least we could do something about it. So let me really go jump to this place. Right, so this is non-relativistic now. We're going down to non-relativistic weak field limit. I just want to point out that, of course, the T mu nu that you just saw, now is what's relevant is just a zero-zero component. That makes life a lot easier. And that's the mass density operator, that term there. This is really the non-relativistic form. And then you add in the potential if you want to look for a cat in a well, a potential well. So what that boils down to, the noise kernel, in the non-relativistic weak field limit boils down to this equation here. You can recognize it, the 2-point function. We wrote it as C and C here, but what the real identity in this, that schematic, the real identity here is the mass density, okay, two-point function. And so that's the noise kernel coming in to play. This just says that really these are distributions. Be careful, you need to introduce a test function to get something physically meaningful. There's actually a big issue behind this because even how you define fluctuation, people haven't really looked hard into it, okay? Especially in a covariant way. That's what we promised from the beginning, right? In the framework of Einstein-Langevin equation. The Wigner function representation Oh, you all know about it. So I just want to point out there is a difference here. If you were doing things classically, you will get a fourth the quartic power here, okay? Because really, the quantum feature comes in the interference terms, and that's what explains the second order. Another warning is that the fluctuation could take on as the same order of magnitude as the mean mass density. That by itself is already telling us something. Even at low energy, even at today's energy. A third point of noteworthy point is that these are highly normal coefficient. This memory, gravity has memory in it. The nonlinearity certainly plays a role. All right, so here, if I have only 5 minutes left, these are the five slides I should show you, okay? All right, so quantum optomechanics, I refer to the experimental setup. There's a big advances in recent years, the last 5 years or so. You can see from these references here. These two papers were posted really just in the last 2 months. Well, today's April 1st, in the last 3 months, okay, down here. And these are really superb experimentalists leading of course, they do many, many things, but as far as gravity is concerned, the optomechanics part is what gives us. We're familiar with one already, the LIGO. The LIGO detector, it works the other way, okay? Mechanically shaking it disturbs the optical field, gives you really, really sensitive signal readings and so on. Okay, good. So the cast stays right there, okay, L plus, L minus. And if I put a detector here, and we analyze two situations. One is classical, the other is quantum, okay? Right, so classical probe sitting there. And you can work this out easily. As I said, this is really the second year quantum mechanics course. You don't even need too much general relativity, right, for this Newtonian setup. And the force is, there's a plus and minus sign there. This is writing it as a projection operator onto the left or the right over there. So the gravitational force behaves as a quantum variable. Its probability correlation is determined by quantum mechanics. And what this gives us, okay, so now this is what the experimentalists would like to see. It's a quantum jump, really. And they are experienced in dealing with quantum jump because, in fact, it came from quantum optics there. So because notice this is classical probe. It's not sensitive to the quantum interference, behavior there. What it's reading out is the quantum nature is really in the cat state itself. That's why I mentioned earlier, you have to first find out a way to prepare the cat state, okay? To make sure that it is indeed a live cat, okay? Not live and dead cat, okay? The reading there comes from these two. And you can see that there's a tunneling probability between the two there. But because it's a classical detector, you don't have anything. You have certainty, you know, within the range of measurement, and then either yes, no, no, yes, that kind of probability. So that's the correlation function that I showed you just now, which of course hinges on this function, which would show up in the measurement. Right, anything else? Okay, quantum, right. So quantum probe, we would put a quantum oscillator, what better, right? Quantum oscillator. And you can see this is the gravitational cat state. I didn't have time to mention that. And this is the harmonic oscillator. And the interaction Hamiltonian is basically sigma 3 times x. This is the displacement. So again, so this is something, again, if you look at it carefully, it's called the James-Cummings model, also beloved by the our quantum optics colleagues. Now, the major difference is that you cannot treat this in the way that quantum optics people treat the James-Cummings model, meaning making the rotating wave approximation in particular, okay? You have to keep everything, and also you have to do it with the strong coupling limit. So what we did here was divide it into two situations, the adiabatic limit, meaning that I'm not allowing for the tunneling to happen. So now you can see the quantum nature of the detector sort of at play here. so it's the superposition of two oscillations around different centers, distinguished only by those two states. And the upshot is that, well, so, and then we allow for a little bit of tunneling, okay, to be fair, right, because it's a two-state system here. And we actually can do some calculation and come up with some result here. Again, the result is something very familiar for people in quantum optics. There's a Rabi oscillation going on, okay? So these are all really homey things, concept-wise. The difficulty, of course, is that it's extremely weak, okay, all these factors. But our recent sort of search, mainly Minnelli, found out that, I'll just say this in one word, details you can see in that recent posting, they are still about 8 orders of magnitude away from actually sort of seeing these effects. But if you look at their progress in the last decade, there's hope, okay, within the coming decade that they will come quite close to it. There's a lot of very ingenious sort of suggestions of combining the best of all the half a dozen schemes that's proven useful in atom and quantum optics. All right, but for theorists here, okay, at least, you know, I find some of these things worth sort of chewing a little bit on, a little bit further implications. So the gravitational field is slave to the matter, right? So the gravitational force is represented by an operator on the Hilbert space of the matter. So that's sort of the quantum, right? The gravitational, if matter is quantum, then it actually passes that on to the gravitational field. Now, the standard interpretation, this is what we usually would hear people say, once we measure a force on a test particle of mass m, we could calculate the field strength, and the field strength corresponds to gravitational potential. In the weak field limit of general relativity, the potential appears in the G0 component of the metric tensor. That's all correct here. However, if you are strict on, from the vantage point of general relativity, space-time and quantum matter intimately linked, here comes the question, do quantum fluctuations of the force define quantum fluctuation of space-time geometry? That, of course, was the issue addressed by stochastic gravity. At least that was the motivation. And in fact, there is an equation that you can solve to tackle this issue. Then the operational definition of space-time geometry seemed to agree on that. If this is true, right, the state we consider here is a genuine gravitational cat state. By genuine, we mean really, remember what Penrose was sort of telling us, there's a fundamental clash between quantum and gravity. And that should show up. This is probably the simplest place and the most elementary yet important place that it will show up, the cat state, the gravitational cat state. Does the gravitational force remain slaved to the mass density as classical GR dictates, even if the latter behaves quantum mechanically, right? It has fluctuations, but you know, it's subject to quantum measurement and so on, okay? Never mind about this right-hand side is sort of a comment, you know, it's more important to raise the questions. So in principle, we could construct probes that we call quantum jumps of the gravitational force. That's for a classical probe, okay? Can we talk about quantum jumps on the gravitational potential? Now that's pushing it to be a little bit more and more sort of quantum, right? Demanding the quantum nature of gravity through the gravitational potentials, okay? So the jumps off, in that case, the induced quantum space-time, right? And invoking gravitational decoherence, gravitational field as an environmental quantum system to kill the gravitational cats may solve the problem. This was what I referred to just now. But the intrinsic tension between quantum mechanics and GR remains, okay? So this is the perspective. I think, what's going on here? Okay, wow, that's Google, was it? Wow, comes to take the route very soon, yes, AI, everything, yeah. So in view of the advances of these, right, precision experiments in weak gravitational fields, what's known as this new field gravitational quantum physics, okay, it pays to re-examine the weak field non-relativistic limit of semi-classical Einstein equation. And in particular, if one wants to consider a quantum informational issue, the noise kernel as in stochastic gravity. And finally, conclusion. investigation of quantum information issues of gravitational systems using quantum probes, okay? And focus on non-relativistic system under laboratory conditions, okay? Would already begin to review some of these deeper issues. Now, for the bottom up, you know, I would consider myself bottom up, meaning from low energy up. There's a confusion sometimes, is what is bottom up? This is really from something that we know, quantum field theory and general relativity. And we learned that semi-classical gravity is inadequate, and we need to incorporate in the stochastic gravity theory. Now, this line, okay, when I gave this talk, a little bit, you know, this is of course expanded a lot more in last August in Galliano. They asked each speaker, Steve was there, right? They asked each speaker to pose a question. So this is my question to everybody and myself, of course, foremost. Can we infer attributes of space-time fluctuations from quantum experiments even at the level of Newtonian gravity without appealing to new theory of quantum mechanics or GR? Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you, organizers. Thank you for the hard work. You should read that, okay?
Okay, so we have time for one or two quick questions.
Yes. I don't see a difference between the problem that Hanor seems to be having with gravity and superposition. I don't see a difference between that and a similar problem in quantum electrodynamics. Yeah, you can, whenever you talk about gravitational fields, you can talk about electromagnetic fields, and think of the same problem. Just because we don't think that electromagnetism has much to do with the definition of time, you don't see the problem, but there's no fundamental difference.
So I would turn your comment the other way around. That is, people in QED should start thinking about the covariance problem, right? But of course, what gravity is special here is the diffeomorphism, or people say different terms. What boils down to the simplest thing is really the definition of the Killing vector. To make sure that it's actually defined at every point in space. And if you compare two states, then you are actually referring to two space-times, which demand the simultaneous existence of the Killing vector.
So
that's the thing.
The denied problem of superposition in quantum mechanics. Whereas the rule has been discovered in quantum field theory, and you never encounter any difficulty in calculating.
Right, because you assume one space-time. You assume just one space-time, right? Your field is defined in one.
No, the rule is, you use the word space-time all the time, but I see a problem that would already emerge in perturbative quantum gravity. But perturbative quantum gravity is in no way different from perturbative QED.
Yes.
So, and whereas in QED we know exactly how to return Poisson brackets into commutators. That's all you need to understand. Mm-hmm. And then you can do the quantum mechanics. I think the same thing is true for perturbative gravity. Perturbative gravity, we have Poisson brackets, it's an action theory. We have exactly the same situation as in any other theory based on an action. There's action and reaction, there are canonical variables, there are Poisson brackets, you replace them with commutators, and here you are, that's your Schrödinger equation. No problem.
I think the issue really is the time. Right, you have sort of a universal time in mind when we write down those theories that you mentioned.
Yeah, but always in gravity you have to fix a gauge to define what time is. That's true, but there is no problem there. There's no problem in formulating the right theory.
There's no problem in writing down a set of equations, right? Like including those theories that you mentioned. What he's saying is that the space-time actually is what allows you to define a Killing vector, which allows you to define a stationary state. So he's really referring to the covariance problem underlying that.
I'm referring to the equations. So when I see a model like this, I just ask which equations do I have to solve to find the outcome of any experiment. And that's straightforward in perturbed with gravity as it is in QED.
Yeah.
We know how to do any particle experiment in QED. I mentioned QED because they are forced
right.
astronauts.
Because they are experiments. Yeah.
So at LHC, they do these experiments all the time. You know
yeah.
exactly what the theory is.
Yeah. Let me
in reality, it should be the same way.
Yeah. Let me address that question from a different angle. So what, after three or four slides, he said, well, it amounts to self-energy. If your system doesn't have sort of enough, sort of large enough mass, which induces significant self-gravity, what you said, I think, is fine. So that's why, you know, people actually look at these issues in those cases when the self-gravity plays a more important role. In fact, in the Dioxy Penrose, it's totally different because their collapse is on configuration space, okay? If you really do GR and do the correct gravitational decoherence, it actually collapses, should collapse on the energy space, right? But what they want actually, they actually wrote down the self-energy term, sort of put in by hand, Leos Dioxy actually did that, and then say that's the term that will give you the localization.
So you would have the same problem in electrodynamics, and there we all know what to do. Because the forces are strong, so we can actually do the experiments much easier and see there's no problem with what the theory predicts. Actually, the same is true for gravity, certainly at the level of Newtonian gravity that he is considering. The only problem is your problem of defining what time is.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is not what the equations are.
So, I think we're actually quite a bit over time, so I think we should. This is a good discussion to continue over coffee because it's, I think, quite deep. So, anyway, let's come back at 10:04. Okay?
Thank you. And the Newtonian in-body problem, the relation and the description of the Newtonian in-body problem. And this goes back because Julian in the 90s, I just confirmed it with him over the coffee break. He was visiting Princeton. And he was asked what he's working on. And he said, I'm working on the Newtonian three-body problem with the hope to change the foundations of quantum gravity, with the hope to get insights about the foundations of quantum gravity. And this is precisely the spirit in which the first half of this talk is to look at the Newtonian limit. Later, I will say, and if I don't cover all of that part of my talk, then I will just say the very similar things work out for general relativity. Behold, of course, the quantum field theory aspects, but the classical part, to a large extent, works out in a very similar way as in the classical model that I present here. So, you went to Julian's talk, and he gave already, and Flavia also, they gave a motivation for why the description of the universe as a whole has to be relational. And this is just, so I will not dwell on that for a very long time. I will just say, is this because the universe, by definition, has to contain all reference structures that we use to define any kind, for example, a reference frame, if you want that, but at least to define units of, say, scale, duration. You can have also units of mass if you want. They all are defined as ratios that you define by choosing a reference object in the universe. For example, our definition of the second and the meter is basically given by using the cesium-133 atom as a reference system. And then you specify a particular property of that species of atoms. And that defines you what a second is and later what a meter is. So this is just to motivate when you want to describe the universe as a whole. The only thing that you can objectively say about the universe is a succession of these relational configurations. And relational configurations, Julian coined the word shapes for that. There is, and in the n-body problem, it's actually the shape that is traced out by n-point particles, which maybe in major part of this talk. And so when you look at that, there should be no unit of scale, there should be no unit of time in the definition of the system. So it has so all that you can objectively say from this relational motivation about the universe, all you can objectively predict is an unparametrized curve on shape space. And this was actually already a thought that an observation that Einstein made, but did not follow up. He wrote it down towards the end of his life. He said, it's striking that the theory introduces two kinds of physical things. This is, one is the measuring rods and clocks, the things that define what space-time should mean. And two, all other things, for example, the electromagnetic field, point particles, or material fields. And then he went on and said, this in a certain sense is inconsistent, because the measuring clocks and rods, they're just part of the second kind of thing. And strictly speaking, measuring clocks and rods would have to be represented as solutions of the basic equations, not, as it were, as theoretically self-sufficient entities. So with that, with having such an authority talking about the relational foundations of GR, of general relativity, I have hopefully motivated that you want a fully relational description of the universe. So what I want is, of course, a mathematical or a theoretical description of the universe. And this, as I just motivated, this should be an unparametrized curve in shape space. So how can we do that? So shape space, here's a cartoon picture of it, is just the space of all relational configurations. So in two slides, I think, I will give you an explicit coordinate representation of that. And so I introduce coordinates QA on shape space, local coordinates in a patch here. And then I want to describe this red curve here mathematically that is generated by the evolution. So what data does not depend on the parametrization? Well, what does not depend on the parametrization is the unit tangent vector, the direction of the change of shape. Well, it's the modulus of the direction because you can go forward and backward. That still at least needs the partial order. It needs the linear order of the curve on shape space. And if you want to get away with that, then you just have the modulus of these directions here. So a unit tangent vector is parametrized by direction variables, which I call phi. And then it turns out to have interesting models, you need a little bit more. You cannot just start out with a point in the direction. You need one additional datum about the curve to write down a system of equations that evolves the curve. And one thing that one can do is shape space comes naturally, at least for the n-body problem, with the complexity function and with the kinematic metric. And the kinematic metric is really the metric that Julian introduced as the best matching of configurations. And that just depends on the shape, because you mod out by the translations, the rotations, and overall scale transformations, which then make the Euclidean metric on R3n into a metric that just depends on the shape degrees of freedom. Of course, this is an implicit definition, and working it out in the explicit coordinates that I use here is actually quite complicated. But once you have such a metric, the metric has geodesics, and you can have the deviation from these geodesics. So these KAs would be, here I have how the tangent direction changes for a geodesic, and here's how the tangent direction changes for the actual curve, and I take the arc length derivative of this. So that gives me the geodesic deviation, and with that I have the extrinsic curvature. I can calculate the length of that is the extrinsic curvature of this curve calculated from this metric, from the kinematic metric. So if I, yeah, oh, yes, okay. So if I, I'm presenting this here with the aim that at the end I want to do the I want to describe the theory of the entire universe. I mean, this is a very high aim, and so fundamentally, you would say, well, how would you go about defining such a theory? Well, you postulate the shape space and the structure that you need on it to define the dynamical system. Then you define the dynamical system as some unparametrized differential equations, so just some ratios that the differentials have to satisfy, and then you can integrate it with an arbitrary parametrization condition, but you don't give any physical meaning to this parametrization condition, you just give meaning to the curve that you obtain, that is determined by this system. But then that's a very abstract thing, and we have very little intuition about what shape space is and what shape space looks like. But then you have to ask, well, I have done away with all kinds of reference structures, but they're actually quite useful in our description. So you go into the system, you go into this curve on shape space, and ask, what does it feel like to live in this universe? What does it feel like if I use some subsystem, and I will call it a local subsystem, and later I will define what I mean with that, on shape space to provide me with reference structure that I can then later use to describe, in a second step, to describe the rest of the universe or the universe as a whole using these reference structures as units of length and time, for example. So this is, of course, the aim, and this is also what I will do in the first half of the talk. I will just go down this route. But of course, you have to be infinitely smart, or you have to be very smart to do that. And a humble thing that I have to do, and that I did to get to this description, was an effective way. And this was, I looked at an explicit example at the Newtonian n-body problem, and I looked at the standard phase space, I looked at the parameterized Hamiltonian and the equations of motion that it generates. And then I projected this set of equations of motion down to an unparametrized curve and shape space and deduced, and it's a straightforward calculation what you have to do, you can eliminate all units from that, and you can get a description of the dynamical system that looks just like I wanted it here. So how the shape changes, how the direction changes along when you go along the curve, and how the extrinsic curvature changes as you go along the curve. And one side remark here, the first line here is actually tautological, because it just says that the change of the shape is in the direction of the change. Actually, there's a plus minus ambiguity if you have if you don't have the linear ordering on the curve, obviously. And so you work out the system, and it dispenses of all dimensionful quantities and just determines an unparametrized curve in shape space. So when you look at these two ways of describing the system, then you see that you can, in a very large set of cases, you can go back and forth between these two descriptions. But already in the Newtonian n-body problem, there is at least one situation where you can't. And this is when you have the total collision, when all particles collide in one point. They will be approached in an asymptotic shape, and the curve, the fundamental equations for the curve on shape space are well defined at this point, while the Newtonian equations are not. And this is because here there it happens in a zero phase space volume. Here there is actually a finite phase space volume. The topology of the manifold on which you define this dynamical system is just fundamentally different when this point is reached. And that has fundamental differences, as Flavio already explained for the Bianchi model. So now I give you, these are lots of equations, and I'm just showing you the explicit equations, not to discuss them in detail, just to show you that you can actually do this, that you can actually postulate fundamental equations that define an unparametrized curve on shape space. So what you start with is you start with, for the Newtonian n-body problem, you have 3n coordinates, and you mod out by translations, by rotations, and by global scale transformations. So you have, so what you will end up with is at the end that you have local coordinates on shape space that are 3n minus 7 independent ratios of this form, where you take differences, where you take the length, and then the ratio. The ratio of the length of differences is something that is translation, rotation, and scale invariant by construction. And then you use the kinematic metric, the best matched metric, which defines your metric structure on this shape space. And another thing that is very useful is to use the complexity function on shape space and in local coordinates. It can be written in the form that you take the root mean square of all these ratios ij with respect to some reference pair ab and divided by the mean harmonic, by the harmonic mean of this of the same set of quantities, so all of j's. So this is a quantity that measures how clustered the system is. And basically, this is because the harmonic mean is dominated by small ratios, while this is given by the average. The root mean square is given by the average value of these ratios. And so when there are a couple of them that are small, then they will make this quantity here large. And this is, a couple of these ratios will be small if there are clusters, if some particles are close together. So then I can define the dynamical system. What you see here is the first equation is just the kinematic statement of the shape changes in the direction of the shape. Then the second equation has a part that the change of the direction or the change of the unit tangent vector has a geodesic part with respect to this kinematic metric, and the dynamical part that depends on the complexity function that I here just postulate to be so, to be precisely of this form. And then I have an auxiliary equation which makes it a lot easier to write down the equations if you use this auxiliary quantity sigma here. And it has its own equation. And what you see, this quantity sigma here is essentially a placeholder for the extrinsic curvature of the curve on shape space. So locally, it's invertible. It's invertible for in each patch of over shape space, I can invert this. I can invert this relation for kappa and replace kappa and d kappa up here. It's just the equations become a lot bigger when you do that. Yes. Where? No. This is actually a minus sign. Oh, this is a 1/2 here, or so there is a minus 1/2, and then there is a plus. Yes, the plus is do not come out with this rendering. It came out better on my computer. I'm sorry about that. Yes?
One question here. For this to work as a dynamical system, you need a definition of the metric just as a function of the shape variable.
That's right.
The way that you defined it referred back to the coordinates. So do you have some additional equation that gives the metric as a function of shape variables?
Yes, you can. I mean, sorry. There. So this equation up here actually defines it. You take any Newtonian representative for this, for a particular shape, and you take the Euclidean metric there, and you take the minimum over this d-axis by taking the minimum over translations, rotations, and scale transformations.
I guess my question is whether there's any way of defining it without going back to the
I don't know of this
okay.
Of this way. This is a system that I hand pick to later reproduce Newtonian mechanics with it. So if I will make some remarks that I think that I would actually like to go the fundamental direction. So I should not hand pick something that to look like Newtonian mechanics. I should find a simple dynamical system, and then say, what does it look like from the inside? What does this system look like from the inside? And this, I will come to that in a little bit. So now, what does it, I just started saying, what does it look like to live in this universe? You use local reference structures. And actually, it's good to have families of local reference structures. And this dynamical system, because I built it to reproduce Newtonian dynamics, generates, from a rather generic initial conditions, generates lots of two-particle clusters. And when some conditions are fulfilled, and you can specify these conditions precisely in terms of these ratios, so you can specify these conditions on shape space, then these reference structures, these two-particle clusters, evolve almost autonomously. And then they look, then you use them to define your reference structures. For example, you can define the coordinate origin as the center of mass in this Kepler pair, of this two-particle cluster. You can define a frame by the aphelion direction and the direction of the angular momentum. You can define a unit of length by using the astronomical unit the semi-major axis or one of the characteristic length scales of this Kepler ellipse. And of course, the orbital period defines your unit of time. And What is important that this is a useful family of local reference structures is that the Kepler pairs, when they're well separated, are approximately compatible units. So of course, if I use the orbital period of one and the orbital period of another, I have to change units going from one to the other. But the units they don't run out of step; they will march to very good approximation in step. And actually introducing these units makes the description simpler. It goes back to the Newtonian description, which is much simpler than writing down this this system of differential equations. Now, this is a side remark that I did not prepare, but Enrique made me aware of it, that in the discussion that I while I was still at the airport, there was the question, why do we bother about shape space? Why do we not use a much simpler dynamical system? The answer to that is, this system, you can use the Newtonian description and get precisely the same curve on shape space, except in cases where the Newtonian description breaks down, which is, for example, when you reach the total collision. And that's the point where it is important that we have an independent definition of this dynamical system. So yes, for all practical purposes, as long as everything is nice, you don't need to bother about that. This is only at the critical points. This is only important then. So when I referred now to local reference structures, I actually tricked you into believing something that you should doubt when you come purely from shape space, because you have this 3n-7 dimensional space, and what is now local? What is a local reference structure? And in this system, and I say this is locally around a point in shape space. This is a subspace, and you can define this as a distribution on phase space. But let's just say it's a subspace. Some of the shape coordinates are such that their short-term evolution, you can predict the short-term evolution of these degrees of freedom by themselves with very high precision. And it doesn't matter what the state of the rest is. And this gives you a notion of what is local, and this gives you a notion of an experienced topology, because it gives you a notion of nearness. For example, when I look at this distribution, the red points are particles here, this distribution of particles, then of course the nearest neighbors are the ones that are important. So this, for this particle here, it's this one here, so they are local. Then when I want to do something some higher precision, then I might need to include the next neighbors outside of this. And this gives me a whole tree structure, and this structure grows into something. You can grow it out from anywhere, from any reference particle, and you get something that grows like a compatible, like a tree into three-dimensional space. So you get a rough estimate about the topology, and it will, if you have a large number of particles, the experienced topology will be the one of R3. And also by the strength of the interaction, just because in the way I defined the complexity function here, by the strength of the shape-changing force that I used in my definition, you actually have an experienced distance. You say the force should fall off as 1 over length squared, and that gives you just from the dynamics of the system gives you an experienced Euclidean space. So now you want now I have space, but I don't have space-time, and I would like to have a Galilean space-time coming out of that. Now, what I can do is I just do what I said 2 slides earlier. I use a reference structure that is well separated from the rest of the universe, and describe and use my units and reference structures here, and I describe the motion of the universe as a whole in terms of these units. And this this gives a description of the rest of the particles that appears to unfold in a Galilean space-time. So it has an additional time direction, which is clear. This is what I put in when I say I have a dynamical system that generates one specific curve. The curve doesn't splice and branch out. So this is not surprising that I get that. But then it's the nature of this dynamical system that you experience a Galilean symmetry, and this depends on the definition of shape space, that once you make these conventions, you still have form invariance of your equations of motion under translation, rotation, time translation, and Galilei boost. And of course, it doesn't, as long as these reference structures are sufficiently stable, it doesn't matter whether I use this reference structure or that reference structure to explore this system. So I have a spontaneously emergent Newtonian or Galilean space-time, and all I have to do to go from a description here to here is I have to do the Galilei transform between these two systems, and I have to convert units between these two systems. So the astronomical unit and the year here is a different one as here, of course. So and then you have everything. You go to the Newtonian representation, and you get really you just do what I now described. You do everything that I described in words, and you find that you have an effective Newtonian Hamiltonian for this cluster of particles here. And you have also this thing that and now here's the interesting thing. Now this system here, when I just described this cluster, now has a dimension full coupling constant here. Okay, 10 minutes. And this is of course because I introduced units here, but this makes the description. Not the introduction of the unit, but the introduction of the auxiliary structure makes a description of this theory much simpler. I mean, this writing down this Hamiltonian, or even writing down the Hamiltonian equations of motion for this Hamiltonian, is much simpler than the equations that I showed here. Now, this is something that Julian, I believe, already covered in detail. So I will only say that this complexity function is precisely the thing that Julian introduced as a complexity function, and which gives an experienced error of time. So I have a summary of the classical part, and then I will go to the quantum system. So I started with the relational motivation, and I defined your toy model, and in this toy model I use that gives you just an unparametrized curve on shape space, and then I define units relationally within this model, and I find an emergent Newtonian space-time, and I have the role of the reference structures that I use is really that it simplifies the dynamics, and you get standard Newtonian dynamics out of this. So now let me tell you what the idea is, how to do quantum mechanics with that. We tried to play the same game with a Schrödinger equation at the beginning, and there is actually a way to do a dimensionless Schrödinger equation just on shape space. The problem with that equation is that it has the form d psi for dt is a Hamiltonian acting on psi, but this Hamiltonian depends on time. So it depends explicitly on the parametrization. And that's something that I don't want. I made the point that I don't want the parametrization to pop out in this. One way to do this, which also has the upshot that it doesn't require an interpretation of quantum mechanics, is to say quantum mechanics doesn't exist. It's just the analog of Bohmian mechanics with two twists, of course. So in Bohmian mechanics, of course, you add to the standard Schrödinger equation, to the wave function in the standard Schrödinger equation, you add a Bohmian configuration. Now here I do, of course, a Bohmian shape, and I have a wave function on shape space, which satisfies the Schrödinger equation. And then it turns out that I can define an analogous dynamical system. It's just, so you have something that looks like a Bohmian velocity law. You have something that looks like a Schrödinger equation. And you have this auxiliary law that tells you how the extrinsic curvature on shape space has to change. Now, here I don't show you any equations, and with good reason. This is, if you want to have an equivariant an equivariant system for this, and you want it to be a precise quantization of the classical system that I showed you on the previous slides, then these equations become horrible. And this is where I get back to Steve's question. I think I should not do that. This should be a dynamical system like this should be the fundamental description of the dynamics of the universe. It just generates a curve in shape space. It just generates a change of shape. And and later, I say, what does it look like? How do subsystems evolve in that? And if subsystems, in a good approximation, in a sensible limit, look like Newtonian mechanics, and look, and if other properties that you want to be realized in your model are attained in that model, then I'm happy to not quantize, but to define this fundamental system in this way, and later experience what is in there. So let me just say a few words about how this relates to quantum mechanics. Of course, this is not quantum mechanics. This is a dynamical system that generates an unparametrized curve on shape space. But if I live in that space, then the state of my brain, for example, would be part of these shape variables. It would be described by a subspace of shape space. And this is all I can know. But now it is, and this part of the story is exactly like in Bohmian mechanics, or like the inside interpretation of Bohmian mechanics. Now if I have a measurement like interaction of my subsystem that describes me with some other degrees of freedom, then through this measurement like interaction, if I know the law of the universe, then I can assign an empirical wave function to that. And then of course I need the coherence of the I need to have the coherence in this system such that this effect, this empirical wave function, satisfies the Schrödinger equation. It would not, in general, if you don't have the coherence, my pointer position would not be determined, and this empirical wave function would not satisfy Schrödinger. But if you have a large number of degrees of freedom and weak interactions, I don't think there is any problem. The coherence will provide that this will satisfy a Schrödinger equation, an independent Schrödinger equation. And I mean, this is actually why we can do quantum experiments, the fact that we have the coherence. This system then looks like quantum mechanics, a quantum mechanical subsystem. And an interesting side remark on this is what Julian talked about is how can we store local information. And if we generalize this idea that Julian presented, that the gravitational arrow of time is the direction in which local reference structures emerge and in which information can be stored, the capacity to dynamically store information in the system grows, then the growth of the gravitational arrow of time is precisely the direction in which these empirical wave functions collapse, because I update my information and I get an effective collapse of the empirical wave function. But you need to have this information storage that you can even talk about the wave function before and after. Okay, 3 minutes. Good. So, since I'm almost out of time, I will just say this. Of course, you can discuss a semi-classical regime in that, and if you start out with an exact quantization, with a quantization of the Newtonian system that I had, then just like in complete analogy to the to how you get, I mean, there are several steps that you have to be careful about, but in complete analogy to Bohmian mechanics, you get that this dynamical system gets well approximated by the by a classical dynamical system in which only the direction of the change of shape plays a significant role, and everything else is negligible for integrating the system. And then once I have this, or once I have at least this appearing for a subsector, for a subspace of shape space, then I can use the degrees of freedom in that subspace of shape space to experience space-time in the same way as I did before. And now it's even better because now I can use reference atoms which have discrete levels, and I can have a much better control over units because I have a gap, for example, in energy gaps in my atoms. And that defines me a unit of time that is that not a continuum of units of time, but one specific, because I have one ground state and the first exciting state. And so, but what happens in this spirit of dynamical models that I presented here is that space-time is only an effective description, as that I already said in the classical discussion, but it's also it's also something that only appears in the semi-classical limit. There is no fundamental space-time in which we talk about to talk about. And so, let me summarize the quantum toy model, and then I will leave the extension to Einstein gravity for tomorrow for people who want to see the system tomorrow and on Sunday. So one can formulate this a dynamical system that generates a curve on shape space that is real, but for someone who lives in that universe that is governed by this dynamical law, he will experience that quantum mechanics is a good description to describe other subsystems. He will also experience, and in at least when a large enough number of degrees of freedom can be treated semi-classically, he will experience a space-time. And also, I put this here, that the collapse of the wave function follows the gravitational error of time, which was a question that was put forward to us, I think, by Steve already in a comment on the paper. You said something about how does the gravitational error of time relate to all the other errors of time, and so there is a partial answer at least at this heuristic level that I presented here. So to come back to the motivation that Julian gave at the very beginning is that we study the Newtonian n-body problem with the idea to learn about what quantum gravity could be. And in this, if these relational ideas are the right way to think about it, then the fundamental description of the universe or quantum gravity neither requires space-time nor quantum mechanics. They're both empirical concepts that are an effective description for inhabitants of the universe, but they're not fundamental entities that need to enter any definition of the system. So now I skip over how to extend this to Einstein gravity, and I will just summarize. But I already summarized the system. So I mean the basic punchline that I want for you to take away from this is there is a good from relational first considerations, there's a good motivation to look at dynamical systems of this sort that I presented. And when you believe that is the right way to go to find fundamental descriptions of quantum gravity, then these descriptions do not require space-time or space-time geometry, nor do they require to be quantum a priori. Of course, one thing that I didn't talk about here is I have a caveat here. When you try to do that for full gravity, of course, the let me go back a couple of slides. Of course, to define this equation here, the Schrödinger equation for this would be analog to the this would be the deparametrized Wheeler-DeWitt equation in CMC gauge. That is, of course, something that for full quantum gravity with an infinite number of degrees of freedom, we run into the same problems. But now there is one upshot, or one thing that is really different. We don't worry about space-time. We just worry that this is an evolution equation for wave function of spatial conformal geometries. And if we do this, if we can do this, and I have only very heuristic ideas about that, and I will talk a little bit about that on Sunday, but they're really just heuristic ideas, in which direction you could go with that. So with that, I want to thank you for your attention, and I want to thank Sean and Renate and Merce for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to talk about this. Yes, okay. When you take the definition of units that I use here as literal, then it's only approximate. This is the same way in which when we construct a real atomic clock, we want to eliminate all kinds of, it's really a very sophisticated engineering project. And it's the same, so it's only up to some precision. And here we have actually quite good control over the precision, because it means that it's very well clustered, and the ratios are all very large when you take this pair as reference pair. Mm-hmm. Yes, this is precisely this complexity function.
And what if you, because that is an adimensional, it's dimensionless, yes. And what if you add or subtract the unity, one?
No, if you add or subtract something from that here, you see that it doesn't change, well, it does change this definition here, but there is a caveat to that.
Because the
change of shape is derived from the gradient of C. So I don't see how it works, but I cannot see how it affects the curve in shape space. To see it explicitly in these equations, because in these equations it looks like like C appears explicitly.
One more question about.
So I know you kind of had to glaze over the relativistic quantum mechanics you might have done, but I was wondering if there's a relativistic limit in which your effective Schrödinger equation becomes an effective Einstein equation.
So not electromagnetism, but yes, you can. You give me the opportunity to talk about two slides that I didn't talk. So there is a similar dynamical system that is based on the canonical formulation of gravity in York gauge, and there you have basically the conformal metric, the the change of the direction of change of the conformal metric, and something that is again similar to this ratio sigma that I had before, and which is related to the extrinsic curvature of the curve in shapes. It's actually to define the extrinsic curvature. I still cannot do this because I don't have an explicit representation of the metric on conformal superspace, of the kinematic metric on conformal superspace. But if you do that, you can couple it to classical matter, and what you find there is you go through the perturbation theory, and what you find on the next slide is that this is just a Klein-Gordon equation in this, where you have a particular lapse and a particular conformal factor here. So the things that you need to the things that actually then later solve Einstein's equations for the background. Now, for quantum, this was stated here as a caveat. I made progress for in this part. I can add free fields. I can add a free massless scalar field. A free massive scalar field to this description. And essentially things work very very similar to that. but also even that system is in very early stages. I haven't studied anything what is in this system, and so I have to ask you to wait to see what comes out of that.
When you start talking, you should take the mute off. For our last talk of the conference, and certainly not the least, one of the things I like about Eugenio is that he, when he speaks, especially about physics, he always makes you feel like there's something really interesting about to happen, and usually it's true, right? Usually I always leave discussions with him and think, wow, I really learned a lot about physics. And part of that is I think is he doesn't just have like really good technical knowledge of quantum gravity, but also quantum information and all kinds of different fields of physics. And I find it really interesting how he brings in knowledge from these different fields and combines them and comes up with something really interesting. So he started his career, I think, doing loop quantum gravity, spin foams, and he's still doing that. But also, I mean, one of the things I think I know him for most, I guess, was his calculation of the Bekensing-Hawking entropy, but through understanding it as entanglement entropy. And I think that really changed the way I thought about black hole entropy and possibly other people too, I don't know. So since then he's been the entanglement entropy guy with all kinds of interesting results about that. And now he's gonna tell us not about entanglement in black holes, but entanglement in the universe, so yeah.
Thank you, Sean. It's a very kind introduction, and I'm really happy to be here to participate to this conference and to speak here. I would like really to take the opportunity to thank the organizers. So as Sean was saying, there's the expectation that entanglement plays an important role in black holes, and recently we have been working on methods for computing the production of entanglement entropy by black holes. Entanglement entropy production in Hawking radiation. And it turns out that many of these methods that we have developed have a wider regime of application. It turns out that black holes are really a fantastic theoretical laboratory. But one is really confronted with these deep puzzles But then once one understands something there, there's always the question, where else we can apply it? Is it relevant for other physics? And today I want to tell you about recent work that we have been doing. It's work in progress, and it's work about entanglement in the sky. I know that everybody in this room is familiar with maps, observational maps of the CMB. This is not one. This is a map of entanglement and correlations in the vacuum of a quantum field generated just with elementary tools that one learns in the first class of quantum mechanics and one takes. And I made it this morning for this talk, and I have a few other that I want to show you. And I'm going to tell you why I'm speaking about this in a moment. So this is the plan of the talk. The first part is rather standard. It's the story of why inflation is so successful. But I'm going to present it not in the standard way that is generally introduced, but with an emphasis on entanglement, because I think that there's really something to say about that and something to learn. In particular, I'm going to tell you about a proposal of origin of primordial entanglement. And that will be the most part of my talk. And in the last probably 10 minutes, I would like to tell you about some more concrete implementation of this idea. OK? So let me start with the vacuum. So just take away everything from the room, the chairs, the tables. We switch off the light. You don't get this, as you know very well. You get the vacuum of all your quantum fields that looks more like this. And I'm going to explain briefly what I mean by this picture. No, it's a standard quantum field theory. What one means is, suppose that I was to make a measurement of the value of the field with a given fixed resolution. One measurement, I don't find the average of the field, that is zero. I find some value of the field that somewhere is positive, like one dispersion, one sigma positive, or somewhere else is one sigma negative. And the mathematics behind that and the theory, quantum field theory, is something that's familiar to everybody. It's not so different from the physics of the harmonic oscillator. It's one harmonic oscillator per each momentum. So the vacuum is the state of no particles, defined by state annihilated by the annihilation operator. And as I was saying, the expectation value of the fields in this state is zero. Doesn't mean that there are no fluctuations of the field. And a way to see that is to look at the following. You know that one can compute the two-point functions, the two-point function in momentum space for given momenta. Just because of isotropy of space, this has to be a delta function in k. These are fields Fourier transform at a given time. And this function that appears in front here is what is called the power spectrum. That for the Minkowski vacuum is just 1 over 2k. And I'm putting it in this form because it's really the language that cosmologists use, the power spectrum. And then if you ask what is the two-point function in space, you take two points that are space-like separated, and it turns out that they are correlated, they are entangled. And they are entangled in the sense that the two-point function space-like separation doesn't vanish. In fact, it diverges at coincident points. And one consequence of this fact is that if you were to smear the field over a region of a given size and say that your detector only measures the field within that region, then possible outcomes are distributed Gaussianly. They have zero average. And the dispersion goes like one over the size of the region. So the smaller the resolution, the smallest the scale, the highest the resolution, the higher the resolution of my detector, the larger the fluctuations. And this diagram is, you just extract from this ensemble just one configuration that you can generate from that probability distribution. And here I'm just plotting surfaces of one sigma positive field, one sigma negative field. And I can generate a bunch of them, all from the same, all extracted from the same state and the same probability distribution. And you see that they are extended. It's not each point fluctuating independently. It's not a random distribution with a uniform spectrum. It's distributed in a very specific way. There are space-like correlations. And that's what one associates to entanglement. Yes? Yes?
You're supposing that you're measuring, that you're, box with a certain precision.
The truncation is in momentum space. I'm assuming that my detector doesn't fill up modes above some momentum. So that's how you get this one. Absolutely. It depends on the detector, what you see. So this is a one definite detector. OK, so why this is associated to entanglement? Well, you know, the prototypical entangled state is what one thinks of a single state of two spins. I should mention at this point something that is closer to the way Schrödinger first described entanglement. That is not you have a state that is entangled, but you explain how you produce it. You say, suppose that I have two systems, like here, an electron and a positron. They are independent, and I bring them in contact. And then I separate them. The final state cannot be described as the state of one system and the other, but is described by one single state. And in this case, I'm giving the example of annihilation that results in entangled photons. And I think it's worth stressing that from 35 to now, this has become something that is really everywhere. You can, in fact, do it at home in your basement laboratory. You don't really need much. You don't really need much. There's a reference to how to produce this positron decay that gives you entangled photons and check that they are entangled. You just need a sodium-22 sample that emits via beta decay electrons and positrons and form positronium and decay in this way. And you check with a Geiger counter. OK, so this is going to come back in a moment. So the state of quantum fields that I've been telling you about, I haven't told you how you prepare it. I just told you that it's the ground state of a quantum field. And something that is closer to the way one thinks about it in quantum field theory is if you think of two harmonic oscillators, they are independent. The ground state is factorized. But if you put a spring between them and you look again at the ground state, we know how to compute it. It's standard quantum mechanics. There are two interesting things to notice. If you expand it on the basis of each one of the oscillators, you find that it's a superposition. So there's a probability distribution, probability of finding each one of the oscillators in a certain state. But every time you find one of them in the first excited, you know for sure that the second is in the same excited state. And besides that, if you make measurements on only one of the oscillators, there are uncertainties. There are uncertainties that come just from the fact that you have this probability distribution, because you are making measurements only on a subsystem. It turns out that the probabilities are distributed like a thermal distribution. In fact, this is playing an important role in the foundations of statistical mechanics in terms of entanglement and entanglement thermalization. And I'm going to be speaking a lot about entanglement entropy in the following. You see already what one means by entanglement entropy. You have this pure state. You make measurements only on a subsystem, and you ask what is the uncertainty of the results of your measurements on the subsystem. The entropy of those probability of those uncertainties is what is called the entanglement entropy. Okay? So I have to give you a state and a set of observables, or a subsystem, if you want. So if you go back to this picture, you find that if I was to measure the electric field, if you want, in this case, the scalar field for this diagram in this region, it could happen that I find the same value two places that are nearby. And this is because they are positively correlated. But in a sample, you can find a distribution of this kind. And now this is for a region of space. And one can ask what happens in other situations. Now, there's something important. That is, these fluctuations are there all the time. We don't really observe them directly because they depend on the resolution you look at. However, there's a mechanism that allows us to observe them in certain situations. That is enhancement of these correlations. And that happens in particular in a set of processes where squeezing is important. And I'm going to describe briefly a few examples that are relevant. But before doing that, I should tell you about two results that we obtained that are directly relevant for these systems, and in particular for primordial entanglement. So the two results are the following. So there's a set of systems that are known to have a production of entanglement that is linear in time. There's a uniform rate of entanglement. This is observed in a wide variety of condensed matter systems. And in our community, we are familiar with a few examples that are the ones that we looked at before. So the result is of the following kind. If you have a quantum system, and you look at a subsystem of that system, you're going to find that generically, for any initial state, the entanglement entropy is going to grow linearly in time if the system is unstable. And the rate of growth is given by the sum of the positive Lyapunov exponents of the system. So a chaotic system is going to give a linear growth of entanglement entropy, so growing uncertainties and squeezing of the state. And physics behind that is, in fact, really easy. It's really considered the typical unstable system, an upside-down potential. You prepare it in the ground state. You let it evolve. You see in red the psi modulo square, the position, the probability of finding the particle at a certain position. And the fact that it spreads in this way, that the state squeezes in this way, when you have a system that is a many-body system, or even a quantum field theory, and you look only at subsystem of the observables, what you're going to find is that this kind of process produces entanglement entropy that grows linearly in time with this rate. So this is the first result that I'm going to use. This was, in fact, a conjecture that I put forward 3 years ago, and we were able to prove only recently, and test in a number of systems. There's a second result that came up really recently. We figured it out a couple of months ago, and we were able to prove it essentially using the same techniques. So this second result doesn't regard instabilities of the kind I was discussing before. It regards systems that are periodically driven. So it's like an harmonic oscillator, but the frequency changes in time. And in this case, we are all familiar with the classical aspects of this parametric resonance. You know, when you are on a swing and there's nobody pushing you, you can still stand and squat at the right time with the right frequency, with the right amplitude, and you keep swinging and beat resistance. And you can even enhance your amplitude. And this enhancement of the amplitude is described by Floquet theory. You compute Floquet exponents, and Floquet exponents tell you how your amplitude is going to increase. And now if you have a system, a many-body system, or a quantum field theory that is periodically driven, like, for instance, as cosmologists know well, quantum fields during reheating. If it's periodically driven, we know that there's going to be particle production. We know that the field is going to be squeezed. And for all this general class, we have a prediction. The entanglement entropy of any subsystem is going to grow linearly in time with a rate that is given by the sum of the positive Floquet exponents. Okay? And prototypical system, harmonic oscillator that oscillates. It is like the person standing and squatting. You have to do it at the right time, like with twice the frequency of the swing. And what you get is that if you are classical and you're at the bottom, you remain there at the bottom. But quantum mechanically, if you start in the ground state, you get enhancement of amplitudes. And if it's a many-body system and you are not looking at this subsystem, but at some other subsystem, it is not diagonal in this decomposition, tensor decomposition of the Hilbert space, you're going to get growth of entanglement entropy. And in the examples that I was giving you before, things were factorized in momentum space, but not in position space. So if you were to make measurements in a finite region, you would see that the entropy of your measurements, the entanglement entropy, grows linearly. OK, so why are these two phenomena relevant for physics in the early universe? OK, before going there, I want to discuss two familiar examples that are Schwinger effect and Hawking radiation, because it's where one gains intuition. No, Schwinger effect is just flat space physics. It's an instability due to the fact that in the presence of a large electric field, you can produce electron-positron pairs. Large electric field means that this electric field has to be large enough to reach the threshold for coupled production. And you know that you start producing them more and more. And if you look at a region of given volume, for instance, you could put a capacitor to produce this electric field, you can ask what's the entropy of electrons alone, not of electrons and positrons, because that's the full state. And you can compute it numerically. It's not too difficult, but still it's a calculation that has to be done numerically. You find this curve. And this linear slope is what we predict by computing classically, without doing any quantum field theory or any quantum mechanics, by computing classically the Lyapunov exponents of the Hamiltonian of QED. Okay? So classical calculation tells you about entanglement rate of production of entanglement. Another example is also rather familiar is Hawking radiation. In fact, that's where we started. We obtained these kind of results using conformal field theory methods, but we were really convinced that it goes beyond quantum conformal field theory. It's really a property of these systems. There's an instability. Hawking radiation is the result of an instability. A black hole starts emitting this radiation because it squeezes the in vacuum. And the more radiation you get, if it's thermal, the entropy grows. And this is a plot of the growth of the entropy in a standard Schwarzschild black hole that was formed by the collapse of a shell. And you see that there's a linear rate that you can relate again to the Lyapunov exponents. And you can extend it to cases where you're really interested in information loss and quantum gravity effects. Okay, so now let's go to cosmology. So I will be speaking about a phase that is later than the Planck scale, during inflation, during slow roll inflation, and possibly reheating. Okay? And I'm going to tell you first the standard story, and then add something to it. So the standard story is that the Minkowski vacuum looks like this. These are a sample of the same kind that I made before. I just increased the resolution, or if you want, I took us a bigger region. And when one speaks about inflation, one says specifically two things. One is that the universe is expanding in an accelerated way. That's a classical statement. The second is that if you prepare your quantum field with correlations at short scales, short compared to the scale of curvature, that are Minkowski-like, they're going to be squeezed and produce what's behind the CMB maps. And so I'm going to start with this picture and then do the squeezing and show you what you get after inflation. You get something like this. And this is a prediction of Mukhanov and Chibisov of 1981. It is the behavior of the power spectrum after slow roll inflation. And the power spectrum is exactly defined as I defined it before. No, and this is at scales, at momenta that are low momenta compared to the curvature scale. So you should think of high momentum just like Minkowski space, but low momenta squeezed so that you get correlations that now are way more long range that possibly you can observe, or possibly you have already observed. It's the standard description of how inflation explains CMB fluctuations. Okay, so going back to the example with harmonic oscillators, what I'm doing is just describing what happens in Mukhanov equation. It's really like having an harmonic oscillator. It's written down here. I don't know if you can see it. It's an harmonic oscillator with a frequency that changes in time. It's beginning is stable, then it opens up, becomes unstable, and then comes back. And this for each mode. So you're going to see something like this, like we saw before for the presence of an instability, just that now it's an instability that lasts for a finite time. So you have your wave function. This is the modulus square. It's peaked, small spreading. Slow roll starts for this mode. Potential goes down. You have that the amplitudes increase. But then you re-enter the Hubble horizon, and you get the oscillations of the modes. And one can ask, again, all the questions about entanglement of our quantum fields in a region. One can ask about 1 meter square region, 1 meter cube region, or Hubble scale regions. and these methods that I've been speaking about apply. So it sends you from this to this, long-range correlations. And if you map it, if you map this on a sphere of a certain radius, and you ask what you would find making a measurement with a cutoff of multiples that in this picture is up to L equals 60, one sample would give you this. Then you take another from this ensemble that is produced just by that state. You would get something like this, something like this. And ultimately, you are interested in explaining the data, the anisotropies in the cosmic microwave background. And as we are familiar with this, what I was showing is not what reproduces this curve. It's what's behind that, that is an almost flat power spectrum. This is what it gives. And then you have to take this as initial conditions for that part of cosmology that is, from the point of view of the field theories, the dirty part where you really have to take into account matter and interaction matter and thermalization. And this is what quantum field theory provides as initial condition for your vacuum fluctuations. OK, so this is the standard picture. And so I've been telling you, essentially, from putting an initial state, it's Minkowski-like in the beginning, evolving it, and then doing what brings us to the CMB. The objective is to see what we learn about the Planck scale out of this data and see how much we can push towards the Planck scale. Okay? So this is the second point, this scenario I wanted to tell you about. So what is this scenario? Well, it's really motivated by the way you think about entanglement if you are not a field theorist. If you're a field theorist, you say, the ground state of my quantum field has these correlations. I don't have to explain why they are there. It's the state that minimizes the energy of my, it's the ground state of my Hamiltonian. Just because the Hamiltonian has spatial derivatives, these correlations are going to be present. However, if you think about it in terms of how you produce an entangled state, you always say you have systems that are unentangled, then they come into contact, they get entangled. And often one says that one motivation for inflation is to explain correlations in fluctuations that without inflation wouldn't be causally connected. But in fact, what one is doing is not explaining that, it's just tracing those correlations in the sky, either in temperature or even in galaxy distribution, tracing them back to a point at the beginning of inflation where these were quantum correlations in the vacuum of your quantum field. So you have not explained the correlations. You have done something that is extremely important, is to trace them back into properties of your quantum field. But you are still assuming that they are already there. And the question I'm asking is, do these correlations have a causal origin? Is there a primordial origin of these correlations in our quantum fields? Like, yeah, you start with an electron and a positron that are unentangled, and then they interact and get entangled. And this is the scenario that we have been looking at. The scenario is partly motivated by the BKR conjecture. BKR conjecture is a conjecture about classical general relativity that tells us that in the approach to space-like singularities, you can neglect spatial derivatives. Points and degrees of freedom that are spatially separate actually decouple. We have heard about that from Steve Carlip in his talk. And what we have been looking at is a possible quantum version of this. No? Is there a quantum version of this? Because if you think about your quantum fields, the origin of correlations of space-like separation are really spatial derivatives in the Hamiltonian. And if you can neglect them, there's no reason why the ground state should have these correlations. Okay? So what we are proposing as a scenario is that there are natural initial conditions in quantum gravity. States that solve the Hamiltonian constraint and meet as a boundary condition in the limit close to a Planck curvature phase, or formally scale factor going to zero, where your solution of the Wheeler-De Witt equation is just factorized over points. You would never write this in quantum field theory. But here, there's something new. There's something that really comes from a property of general relativity. So this is what's behind the proposal. And the scenario is that in a pre-inflationary phase, our quantum fluctuations, or even our state of the quantum geometry, was unentangled. And then the pre-inflationary phase produced these correlations and gave us in vacuum, or the adiabatic vacuum that is used in cosmology. Now, you're not going to get exactly the same state, because squeezing doesn't work like that. So together with being a scenario of a pre-inflationary phase is something that you can constrain with present data. OK, so there are two things that you can probably not read. One is that this is really related to the asymptotic silence that Steve Carlip was mentioning. In a sense, this is silence, entanglement silence. OK? It's a scenario of entanglement silence. And the second is that this conjecture is motivated by a work that I've done some time ago together with Rob Myers about when we expect in quantum gravity to have semi-classicality. And the conjecture is that when you get entanglement entropy scales, like the area of the region, you can expect semi-classicality. If you don't satisfy an area law, you should not expect it. And this is, in fact, realized in loop quantum gravity, where you can think of your states, the spin network states that we use as a basis. And as a basis, this is completely unentangled. It's really the state where you have made a measurement everywhere of the volume and the area. It's an eigenstate of all of them, so it's completely localized. And as an entanglement law for regions of space, as a zero law, zero entanglement entropy. And what one expects and what we are testing is how to find semi-classical states with long-range correlations. And they turn out to have automatically an area law. OK, so this is motivation. Now, in how much time do I have left? In the time that I have left,
10 minutes.
Very good. In the time that I have left, I would like to tell you about one possible realization. Clearly, one can try to study this problem in full quantum gravity. It's difficult. It's worth trying. What I'm going to tell you about is something easier, and maybe easier also to match with observations. That is, to look at what we already know, quantum field theory in curved space-time and dynamical backgrounds, but try to take into account as much as we can possible quantum corrections. Okay? So that's the second part of my talk. I'm going to skip quickly through these Planck constraints. I think it's important to know that there's actually something that has happened between 2013 and 2015. That is, in 2013, the constraints on the primordial tilt and tensor to scalar ratio were of this kind. There were various models. In particular, I'm showing here quadratic potential for the inflaton and the plateau potentials, and still allowed. And the data from 2015 essentially exclude at 1 sigma quadratic potentials, while potentials of a plateau type really sit in the sweet spot over there. And I think that this is really good news for us in quantum gravity, because this model is one of the first inflationary models proposed, Starobinsky in 1979, starting from motivation was quantum gravity corrections. It's what you get starting from general relativity with quantum corrections of the form R plus R squared. And so what I'm going to do is to take seriously this observational indication and study this theory, R plus alpha squared. No? This is generally done by going to this conformal frame and going back to a scalar field. I really want to do it by staying with the metric and see what I can learn about quantum gravity, because at this point I can study the classical evolution of a background, for instance, a Freeman-Lemaitre Robertson-Walker background. And quantum fluctuations are metric fluctuations. There's no inflaton. And this theory is known to have an inflationary phase. And this is inflation that is not driven by an extra scalar field that you have to introduce and postulate a potential and fit parameters in a potential. There's just one parameter, this alpha, that in principle you have to measure. And this has been studied. This has been studied in our form, so there are constraints. It's mostly studied by going to this conformal frame, but to learn it, we have worked it out again in what we call the physical space-time, just in these terms. You can find the spectral amplitude, the NS and R, and you see that with the number of refoldings, R goes like 1 over n squared. That's what makes it so small that fits so well the data. And by fitting the data, you see that you need alpha that has dimensions of area. So as a length, square root of alpha should be 10 to the 5 L Planck. So to me, this is the closest we have got up to now to measurements towards the Planck scale, 10 to the 5 L Planck. If you think of it as a quantum gravity measurement, this is a measurement about this coupling. OK, so let me tell you briefly what we have been trying to do. So this is work in progress. It's work in progress with Miguel Fernandez and Alejandro Satz, a grad student and a postdoc at Penn State. And the previous results about entanglement production are results together with Lucas Sackl and Nelson Yonkomitso, another grad student and postdoc at Penn State. So, and the idea is to apply the first results to this. No? So first of all, we have to identify a scale where to put initial conditions. This should be initial conditions for our classical geometry, the background, and for our quantum fields. Okay? So I discuss first classical geometry. We put initial conditions at a scale of curvature that is not the Planck scale because we don't expect the theory to apply at the Planck scale. But still, the scale of curvature should be much smaller than 10 to the 5 Planck because it's the regime where we already know that it works and we want to go at a time that is pre-inflationary. So you see, you don't really have much space. It's just 5 orders of magnitude. You are really looking at physics within this. You can take L0, for instance, I don't know, 100 Planck lengths, and you're asking what happens between 100 and 10,000. And we have to look for initial conditions at this surface such that at least you get 60 foldings of slow roll inflation. So that's not too difficult. So it turns out that this theory has, if you put in a Freeman-Lemaitre Robertson Walker background, has good initial conditions and equations of motion that are essentially given in terms of the Hubble rate, h, and its proper time derivative, h dot. Okay? So in particular, Einstein equations, or modified Einstein equations with a quantum correction, they're going to give you a trajectory in this HH dot space. And I want to put initial conditions not at the slow roll phase. I don't want to assume that there's a slow roll phase. I want to put almost Planck scale initial conditions, or post Planckian initial conditions. So I look at this L naught curvature scale. I plot it in this space, and you get this cardioid, this elliptic curve. And every point here is a point that can be possible initial condition. Everything outside is Planckian, so I don't want to look at things outside. I'm only interested in things inside. And I have to look at how things evolve. And this it's good to do it qualitatively before doing it numerically. We have worked this out, but I think it's still more interesting to look at it qualitatively. So this is the vector field everywhere. Here it goes up, here it goes down. At this green curve is where it's horizontal. So from this plot, you already see that if you put initial conditions here, you go towards Planckian. That's not good. If you put initial conditions here, you go down. If you put initial conditions here, you go up. So let me show you one plus our few classical curves. Here, you reach this point. Here, you go up. You follow this, that is a slow roll phase. And then you have a reheating phase, or at least an oscillatory phase in h and h dot. Many points are excluded because go Planckian. This point has less than 60 foldings, so it's not phenomenologically interesting. But essentially, everything from here up to this point here goes through this attractor, this slow roll inflation and reheating. And what I'm interested in is not doing the standard thing that one always does. It is you start here during slow roll, and you put initial conditions there. Initial conditions that are Minkowskian correlations are scales that are smaller than scale of curvature. I'm interested in putting initial conditions here. I've done it for the classical field. Now I have to put initial conditions for the quantum perturbations. OK. So let me just say it again. When you do that, you match with slow roll and you put initial conditions in the standard way, it's when you get this matching. So now we're asking, can we push it backwards towards the Planck scale? So that was the classical part, quantum perturbations. I just summarized briefly what we have been learning in the last few months. So this is what we have been learning. Quantum perturbations are scalar and tensor modes of the geometry alone. There's no inflaton, as I've already said, and we have to prepare them in some state. You are free to choose the state. You could, in principle, choose a state that is Minkowskian at small scales, but you have to ask if you have a good principle, a good reason to do that. And what I'm going to propose as a state is this state that is BKEL motivated, is entanglement silence at that scale. So no correlations at scales above the curvature scale. Now, generally, when one wants to do that in quantum field theory in curved space-time, they tell you immediately you cannot do that because this state will be high energy, possibly if divergences in the energy momentum tensor, because you need these correlations to lower the energy density. But those statements apply when you are at scales that are below the scale of curvature. No, where you can approximate space with flat and you impose the Hadamard condition. But here we are exactly in the regime where there's going to be nothing that is below that length scale because the curvature scale is increasing, so that length goes to zero, and so essentially there's nothing left. No? So if you want, you can put these Minkowskian correlations inside these small patches, but outside you have to decide what to do with your field. And there's a rather natural way of implementing no correlations outside, at least in the limit, so that it goes smoothly to that. So that's the class of states that we have taken. We put initial states in the pre-slow-roll phase of this kind, and we check that you generate Minkowskian correlations. So first interesting thing is that out of that, you can argue that the correlations that you see in the sky that were previously traced back to the slow-roll and correlations in the quantum field, but not yet explained causally, now they are explained causally by going a bit backwards, a bit more, and putting no correlations and letting the dynamic produce the correlations. Exactly like, this electron and positron that they are not correlated, they interact and they get correlated. Or like in many condensed matter systems where this is well studied. They get produced by this squeezing, by the instability. Now, there are two things that we have been exploring that I think is, well, it's really why I'm interested in this project. One has been already mentioned by Guglielmo and Amarugani in his talk. It is, you should expect corrections once you change initial states, whatever the reason is you're changing initial states, and you know where to expect them. You are going to expect them at large scales or at low L. And here you can check what kind of corrections you get. There's an interference term that can either enhance or suppress the power at low L. Now, there is some mild evidence that there's a suppression at low L. We don't know yet. We are going to know in a few years, not from CMB, not from temperature measurement, but from other measurements that beat cosmic variance. But that's a window for observation. And if you measure something there, you can ask, can you trace it backwards at this L-naught scale and put constraints on the physics at that L-naught scale? The second is something that has to do with that final phase, the phase of oscillatory behavior, this phase. So this is a phase where it's not your inflaton that is rolling down a potential and oscillating. This is a phase where it's the metric that has a curvature that is doing this. And if it's a metric, metric couples to everything. So every field, gravitons, curvature perturbations, electromagnetic field, or whatever you have at that scale, is going to be excited. You're going to get particle production. Now, in standard preheating theory, one really looks at this periodically driven system and Floquet phenomena. But you do have to postulate a coupling between your inflaton that is oscillating and some modern matter field. And you postulate the coupling, for instance, a quadratic-quadratic coupling, so quartic term. You have to introduce this other scalar field, so you already have two that you don't know much about. And you have parameters. And it's where in cosmology, as I understand, cosmology is becoming a precision cosmology now, but this is really the point, the place where we don't know much yet, this rating phase. And here you don't have any freedom. You cannot choose the coupling, because the coupling, if you accept the fields minimally coupled to gravity, coupling is fixed. And recently, very recently, in fact, Larry Ford, together with Chiappa Casse, have looked at this graviton creation in the presence of scale factor oscillations, and they find that short times you get graviton production, and yeah, one can say even more, one can say how many of them you produce, for how long, and what frequency. The frequency is square root of alpha, no? And exactly like with this graviton production, also all of the fields that were initially in the vacuum get excited. With an entropy that you can predict, it's just given by the sum of the positive flow k exponents times the amount of time this rating phase lasts, and you can count how many times it oscillates and get that. So that's what we are looking at now. And I think I'll stop here. Thank you very much for the attention.
Okay, interesting stuff. Questions? Yes, first.
Yeah, so one question. So what you do is before slow roll, you assume this vacuum without any correlations, and then you just let it evolve. In the slow roll phase, do you get what we expect?
Yeah. Okay, you get not Bunch Davis, you get Bunch Davis with some squeezing on top of it. If you were to get exactly Bunch Davis, there wouldn't be anything new.
Yeah, no,
if so if you were to put Bunch Davis here, you would get the right departure from scale invariance and the NS that we know. Now we are saying, What if here I put something that is not Bunch Davis, but something that is a bit more squeezed? It's Bunch Davis plus a bunch of particles entangled in a certain way. So there's a sort of standard understanding that the dilution will just dilute all the particles and you wouldn't get any effects. But this neglects the fact that there's stimulated emission. And stimulated emission at a scale that is generally something that we don't see because it's above our horizon. So if you have this preinflationary phase that is close to being 60 foldings, not 60 foldings for every mode, but yeah, inflation starts and ends. So I can speak about the total amount of inflation. If it's close to 60 foldings, you see effects at low L. If you have many more than 60 foldings, well, you wouldn't see anything. So it's a small window. Yeah, I think one can ask the same question already at the classical Hamiltonian level. What results we have about BKL in classical Hamiltonian general relativity, because the momentum constraint has the derivative, can we neglect it or not? So I do know an expert on that is sitting in the back, Dave Sloan, and he has worked on that. And if I understand correctly, at least at the classical level, BKL goes through.
Okay, so first Flavio, and then.
What if you rewrite this in the Jordan frame when you introduce it, you just get a model of single field inflation with a particular set of problems?
Yeah, you would have single field inflation. If you were to couple all the fields, they wouldn't be minimally coupled. It would be coupled in a strange way. And you wouldn't. You could translate everything and nothing would look natural anymore. That's what I'm saying. There are things that are natural in the physical space-time. You know, you say that this is the first correction. You wouldn't ever say that this plateau potential is the first correction to, I don't know, Scarafidi. In fact, cosmologists fit this, if I understand correctly, with a few parameters, and you check that these parameters are not free. And yeah, you have only one parameter, and it fits just as well. So if you check this encyclopedia in Flationaris, you find that this one is one of the preferred models, really from the point of view of, you know, checking what is the statistical probability this one is better than the others.
So the last question.
I didn't know that.
The trace anomaly. But then, of course, we realized that there are runaway solutions, which later on, of course, people say is a very desirable thing, known as inflation. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know how many people, after reading Alexei's paper, Sarbinsky's paper, understood clearly, you seem to, because you are saying what it is. How do you go from, let's say, BLK, and then kick in to the R-square theory, and then generate slow roll. In fact, even going from BKL to the R-square theory, don't you have need to have the R-square going along with the BKL? And somehow you have to say that the BKL dominates. At an earlier time, then even the R-square theory, which supposedly should work earlier than that, in terms of the trace anomaly effect on that. So there are two crucial things for you to be able to tell that story in three connected pieces.
Yeah.
Could you address those two critical points?
Partly. So first, the way I told you about this is the simplest way that I can think of, that is I first assume homogeneous and isotropic. No? So I cannot speak about BKL anymore because I'm already assuming homogeneous energy. And get these plots. And then look at small perturbations and look at what happens to small perturbations. So I can tell you that spatial derivatives of the perturbations can be neglected. That's just indication. It's less than what you're asking. Then there's the hard question that you're asking. And in fact, the partial answer that I have really goes to using this conformal frame as a trick, as I like to think of it. You just rewrite everything in terms of a scalar field. You have ordinary gravity with a scalar field in this auxiliary space-time. And now you ask, can I prove BKL for this auxiliary theory? And it turns out that BKL's paper is not just about general relativity alone, but you can do it general relativity with a scalar field. And it admits one of these solutions, that is BKL in the sense of being specialized separated points don't speak to each other, but not BKL in the sense of being chaotic. You don't get any chaos. So that's the only argument that I have in support of this. Now, I would be more satisfied with having an argument that doesn't have a go through the other frame and it's just within this picture, and we are definitely looking at it.
Okay, so before I thank you again, I'm just we're going to do a two-minute wrap-up.
We thank him again.
We will thank him.
Thank him and let him go.
No. I would say, don't leave.
Thank you.
Thank you.